Hello, good evening, everyone. Welcome to our Meetup Live event. The topic tonight is how to dismantle social injustice. And we appreciate this opportunity to partner with and hear from experts as we discuss what's been happening and what we need to happen in order to really drive social change. Our hope is that you gain insight, understanding, and next steps for yourself so that you can play a part to help dismantle systemic racism. Before we get started, let me share a quick guideline on how we will be interacting this evening. Next slide, please. You may have noticed that this event is being recorded, but only the panelists and I will be visible. Attendee audio has been muted and the chat feature has also been disabled. We welcome you to submit all of your questions via the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen. Next, we'll go over the agenda quickly. So I'll share brief introductions of each panelist, then we'll dive right into the discussion before moving into Q&A. So let's get started. My name is Shade Akande, and I'm the VP of People at Meetup. I'll serve as the moderator this evening. Now on to our esteemed panelists. We have Dr. Naa-Solo Tettey, who is Professor of Public Health, a health disparities researcher, and a food justice advocate. She's also the creator of HeartSmarts, which is an organization that aims to improve cardiovascular health in Black and Latinx communities. Dr. Tettey, with over 15 years of public health experience, is considered an expert in community and faith-based education. Through her work, she aims to empower people and communities to take control of their health and well-being. We also have Rashad Robinson, who is the president of Color of Change, a leading racial justice organization with more than 7 million members. He designs winning strategies to build power for Black communities, moving prosecutors to reduce mass incarceration and police violence, winning net neutrality as a civil rights issue, changing representations of race in Hollywood, moving Airbnb, Google, and Facebook to implement anti-racist initiatives, and forcing Bill O'Reilly off the air. And we have Stephanie L. Young, who serves as the Managing Director for Culture, Communications, and Media Partnerships at When We All Vote, which is a nonpartisan voting initiative launched by Michelle Obama. Stephanie brought strong partnerships and helped recruit over 400 artists, athletes, and influencers, which resulted in reaching over 220 million individuals on social media for When We All Vote. She has over 12 years of strategic communications and public engagement experience, ranging from the Obama White House, political campaigns, House Democratic leadership, and leading television networks, BET and NBC Cable Entertainment. Impressive. So let's begin the discussion. Let's start with present state data. Dr. Tettey, as you know, African American and Latinx populations were affected more severely by coronavirus than any other race. Why is that?
Well, there are many reasons. And actually, before I even answer the question, I just want to thank you all for having this forum, having us here today to have this very important discussion. As it relates to the coronavirus, there are various reasons why we're seeing these disparities. The first being underlying health conditions or pre-existing health conditions like diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, which impact African American communities at higher rates. I'm going to come back to this issue in a second, but just to list what the issues are. The second issue has to do with many people in the African American and Latinx community work in the front lines. So they do things like drive buses, are the postal workers, work in food service. So anything where there's higher rates of exposure, they tend to present more in those types of situations. Another reason why has to do with mistrust of the healthcare system. So when the coronavirus or COVID-19 first came into the forefront, there was a myth going around that African Americans could not contract it. There was another issue in terms of going to the emergency room if someone felt they may be sick. There was the idea that if you go to the emergency room, you're not going to come out alive. And so many people waited too long or didn't go at all and wound up dying at home. And so that was another issue that came up. Having to do with housing, African American and Latino communities tend to be present more in cities. And so as a result, they live in more more densely populated areas, and it's harder to social distance in situations like that. So putting that all together, those would be the surface kind of reasons why we've seen higher rates in the African American and Latino community. But at the foundation of that is structural racism and structurally racist policies and practices that have contributed to those conditions that I just listed.
Got it, thank you. Continuing along the present state data vein, Stephanie, when it comes to voting in America, what have been some of the main challenges?
Well, there's a lot of challenges, unfortunately, when it comes to voting. I would say one of the biggest ones is misinformation and the lack of civic engagement curriculum that is in our school system. I'd also have to obviously mention voter suppression, which is a huge thing, right? When it comes to misinformation, just think about it. When there's big elections happening in your states, I happen to be at home right now in Atlanta, Georgia. I live in New York. There was just a primary here, and I saw candidates advertising on television every day, but I didn't see the state of Georgia advertising, letting folks know when they could vote early, talking about vote by mail, talking about all of the different provisions that have been either expanded, especially due to COVID-19, and really giving people their options to know how to make their voices heard. That's purposeful. Then also, when you think about the fact that civic engagement is no longer in our school system, we have an electorate that does not understand the connection to voting in their lives. And that is a hard fight that we all have to fight, I think, every single day when people think that it doesn't matter if you vote. But 100 million people did not vote in 2016. And that really is a huge sign as to the number of Americans. Over half of Americans don't think that it's worth it. And when it comes to democracies around this world, leading democracies, we're almost last on the list when it comes to how engaged our electorate is. And that is, I think, in due to a large part of the lack of civic engagement curriculum and education. That's why we have programs like My School Votes. But in actuality, that all is a form of voter suppression. And in 2013, after President Obama was reelected, the Voting Rights Act was gutted and certain provisions were taken out of it, protecting voting rights across this country. And you saw states enact really strenuous and draconian laws that prevented people from going to the polls, but also just causes mass confusion. So a big part of what we're trying to do at When We All Vote is to be that partner for the American voter, to give them the tools and resources that they need to not only get registered, but also to get ready to vote and understand all the ways in which they do it by knowing their rights and the opportunities before them.
Got it, thank you. Rashad, there's a gap between perception and reality when it comes to violent crimes in the media. Can you explain to us why that's the case and what's really happening there?
Yes, and thank you for having me. It's great to be with everyone. It's weird, I feel like I'm going a lot of places, talking to a lot of people, and then not leaving the seat in order to do it. And so while I don't feel the energy from all of you, I hope that we can be in good discussion. And so, absolutely right around this sort of gap between perception and reality and sort of all of the ways in which it impacts our ability to actually move and change the course of our society, right? We have a whole set of policies, written rules that impact the criminal justice system. And then we have an unwritten rules, the culture, the cultural narratives that fuel it, that make demands for it. And so for the last 20 years in this country, violent crime has basically steadily went down. But according to Pew Research and others, people, Americans, believe violent crime is going up. And so that's exactly what we have here, a gap between perception and reality. And this gap between perception and reality means people are making deep demands for things like more policing, making deep demands for things like militarized police, all of these things which we know don't make us safe. And so you're probably asking, why is that? How does this gap actually happen? And one of the things that we've really looked at Color of Change is the role that media plays in shaping our sort of understanding of crime, of criminal justice, of policing. And so every single year, there's over 20 crime procedural TV shows. These shows are sort of the Law and Orders, the Chicago PDs. I know they're very, very entertaining. I sometimes watch them myself. But these shows do a couple of things, right? They create a world that is very diverse in cities like New York and Chicago and LA, a world with a lot of people of a lot of different races, but a world that oftentimes does not have racism in it. So a world with race, but without racism. If you look at these shows and you start to look at sort of how they're produced, a show like Law & Order SVU, a show like Chicago PD, literally have all white writers' rooms writing these shows. And one thing that I sort of laugh about, but oftentimes makes me sad, is that if you actually watch crime procedural shows, you'll see that they have way more black judges that exist in the real world. Like, all the shows have a lot of black judges. The judge is always black. And I am not here to take a job away from those brothers and sisters. But what I am here to say is that what ends up happening is that white writers' rooms are sending justice through the mouths of oftentimes symbolic figures that are making us feel like justice is actually being served in those courtrooms. Those judges are not actually given backstories. What would it be like for a 65-year-old black woman to actually be a judge? What must she think about the justice system? She might have opinions about sort of whether or not the criminal justice system is working and might respond differently. Well, what happens is that these shows serve nothing more as a PR arm for police and law enforcement. Over the last several years, we've done a lot of work at Color of Change to push back. In January, we published a report with the USC Norman Lear School called Normalizing Injustice. You can find the report at changehollywood.org. Changehollywood.org is this platform that we are sort of working to shift the narratives and the stories that we tell. Because what we actually have to do in order to get to the policy changes and the implementation is we have to raise the floor on what's acceptable and push up the ceiling on what's possible. And so we've been doing that work through campaigning. Over the last couple of weeks, we've worked to get the TV show Cops canceled from the air. We actually, back in 2013, got it canceled from Fox. And then a couple of months later, it showed up in syndication, and now I hope we've done dealt the final blow to a show that serves nothing more as sort of following law enforcement, allowing them to dictate the entire terms of how these issues happen. These shows never go to Wall Street or Capitol Hill, where sometimes crime happens that really impacts us at a structural level. They go into poor communities that have been targeted by the war on drugs, by austerity, by unfair tax structures, and they bring cameras and they follow people at their very worst, and they only show police at their very best. They call themselves reality shows, but they are nothing close to the actual reality that communities are facing. And so part of what we are trying to do at Color of Change, and I'm gonna talk about the policy work and the work to build more power, but part of what we are trying to do here is also change the story and the narrative. Building a new set of power around the stories that people see so we can build a new type of demand for a system that actually can be on our side, that looks at both safety and justice as the core sort of underlying factors of what we should all have and what we all need in our communities. And so that gap between perception and reality harms us, but our ability to close it is in our hands if we build the type of powerful campaigns that force media outlets that are making so much money off of it to realize that they can no longer do that in our names.
Yes, thank you. Now, let's discuss how we got to where we are, some history. Dr. Tettey, how did the divide in health inequality happen?
So in public health, there's a concept that we talk about called the social determinants of health. And these are factors that determine whether someone will be healthy or not, or will have access to things that we call protective factors to help them stay healthy. So in that realm, we're looking at things like education, employment, and then also factors such as race, gender, religion, all of the different aspects of a person's life that determine their overall health outcomes. However, if there have been things, oppressive things, destructive things that have been done within a person's life or their community that impacts these social determinants, the health outcomes tend to become worse. So if we look at the history of the United States and go back to the times of slavery, that is really where the negative health outcomes begin for Black people in the United States, and there's a trajectory from there till now. So if we look at the concept of historical trauma, when we think about generational trauma and all of that unspoken horror and terrible things that have happened centuries in this country to African Americans, that is embodied That's what we consider embodied racism and internalized racism and things that affect the health in that way. But on a larger scale, when we look at policies, one specific example that we can take a trajectory from, say, 1933 until now would be the Federal Housing Administration and the way in which loans were given to white people to be able to purchase homes in certain communities. And these loans were not given to Black people. And it was actually specifically written that Black people could not have these loans, and people who were looking to live in communities that were near Black people could not have these loans. And you may have heard of a term called redlining. And so that's what it was, specifically redlining and crossing out communities where Black people would reside. And so as a result of these Federal Housing Authority policies, we can see from that point, from 1933 till now, the urban blight that has taken place, the divestment in communities where we have poor education systems, lack of access to jobs, lack of access to proper quality healthcare. All of those things stem from that residential segregation and those policies that came out of housing in the United States. Another example of that is the ability to build wealth. So for African Americans, they have 5% of the wealth of white Americans in this country. That's insane, right? But the number one way in which people build wealth in this country is through home ownership. So if we had a policy that does not allow people to do what they need to do to own a home and build that generational wealth, we see what we have now. Another example of that would be zoning laws that in certain communities prohibit the presence of fast food restaurants, liquor stores, things that create adverse conditions for people's health. In many Black communities, we don't have that. And so we see an overabundance of establishments that contribute to the health disparities that we see. So I had stated in the beginning that we'd come back to the idea that Black people have higher rates of heart disease, hypertension, diabetes. And we often hear those statistics kind of rambled off as if they're fact, in a way that it means that if someone is Black, they're just born with these things. But it is the systematic oppression, these generational policies, generational practices that over time have led to these outcomes. Many of these illnesses that we talk about, my program HeartSmarts focuses on heart disease. They're what we call life course decisions. So someone doesn't just wake up with it, they happen over time. And one of the biggest contributing factors to that is racism and the stress that racism causes on the body, what we consider to be chronic stress. So if we look at all of the other factors that someone who may be living in an impoverished community having to worry about, you know, especially in this climate, worrying about having to go to work and possibly catching COVID or the coronavirus, having to worry about if they're going to be able to pay their rent, maybe perhaps living in a violent neighborhood, worrying about their safety. And on top of all of that, we add race to it, and the stress and the constant chronic stress of having to deal with that. That's where these health inequities come from. So it's a very layered conversation where it's not necessarily one thing, someone ate the wrong thing or someone did the wrong thing. There are various levels to it.
For sure, thank you. Stephanie, what is the history of our voting inequities that brought us to the situation we're in today?
Yeah, so it started way back when, just like Dr. Naa-Solo was mentioning, none of this has happened overnight. And when I think about voter suppression, or when I think about the fact that this country was created for white land owning men, and those were the people that they wanted to vote, the moment, the first time President Lincoln ever said, I'm thinking that maybe we'll have to give Black people the right to vote, he was shot very shortly after that. And I believe that he was shot because of that reason, because voting is power. And you saw that right after Reconstruction, when African-Americans were able to vote, or right when Reconstruction started, I mean, when African-Americans were able to vote, they voted in high numbers. We had representation in the House and in the Senate in a way in which we, you know, hadn't had for pretty much centuries or years and years after that. So voter suppression is ingrained into our system. It's not meant for us. And when you think about the Electoral College, something that is super complicated and outdated, it's a form that was created, I believe, in the late 1700s. I don't have the exact date at the top of my head, but when it was created to ensure that white landowning men in the South had as much power as other white men in the North, and they did not have the numbers of white people in the South considering the high numbers of African Americans. So they said, okay, we'll count you as, you're not really a human, we'll count you as 3/5 of a human so that we can put some of you together and make one whole human so that I can have more representation and more power in Washington, D.C. And that is a system in which we still elect the President of the United States from, which is crazy. So this has all started really at the founding of our country. And I think the beautiful thing about democracy is that you are ever improving, ever evolving. But it's going to take the people to kind of stand up and not just make their voices heard at the polls, but really understand how ingrained these issues are. And then also when you think about the terrorism that happened during Reconstruction and once Reconstruction basically failed, that prohibited or scared people, Black people, from voting, that was real. And we're traumatized by that. And that is something that is carried on through generation. And if anybody ever has the opportunity to go down to Montgomery, Alabama, and go to the memorial, the lynching memorial that was created by Bryan Stevenson and the Equal Justice Initiative, when you see all of these pillars with names of people who were lynched, and then you go to a wall, it looks a lot like the Vietnam Memorial wall, and you read the reasons, I have to say at least maybe 50% of the reasons were register to vote, try to register voters, voted. So it is something that our community was terrorized by for generations, and it has created a system that A, a lot of people don't trust, right? And then B, I think another sense of mass confusion and misinformation, which is another form of voter suppression. And I think year after year, I think that sometimes some of us have taken it for granted, taken the opportunity for granted, and then some of us just have not been able to make the connection with voting in our lives. And that's why when we all vote, we're trying to do the culture work to change the culture around voting so that people are thinking about voting in a different way. And similar to what Rashad said, all the images that you receive of people of color in these shows and how you're looking at cops and who are the criminals and these repetitive images over and over again make an impact on our lives. But if you think about it, have you ever seen anyone in a show that you like standing in line to vote or saying, I'm going to register to vote? If it's not like a highly political show or focused on, some sort of election, right? That is not ingrained in our culture at all because it's not cool. It's not pop culturally acceptable to throw in voting. It's not sexy, as some people like to say. But that, again, to me, is purposeful. And it shows that we're not thinking about voting in the way that I think that we should, which it impacts every aspect of our lives. So one of the things that we've been doing more recently at When We All Vote is making the connection between today, what's happening right now, and how is voting or your elected officials or people who serve as your elected officials, how are they impacting your life through what they're doing right now for COVID-19? How are they protecting you? How are they protecting your state? How are they giving you the resources and things that you need from testing, all of those things? And then you look at the injustice in our justice system. We vote for our mayors who appoint our police chiefs, right? So we vote for the district attorney. So these are things that people have to be able to make real connections with. And we don't invest as a country, as a federal government, in that type of reinforcement and that information. Instead, we leave it to organizations to potentially do that, or we leave it up to a voter to just be confused. So I think it's been a perfect storm of just the history of voting in this country was not for us. It was not meant, not just for Black people. It wasn't meant for anybody but white men initially. And then even when white women got the right to vote in 100 years ago on August 18th, that was white women. But there were Black women in the suffrage movement. They were Native American women in the suffrage movement. There were Hispanic women and Asian women as well that are obviously left out, and voting rights weren't really given until the Voting Rights Act, which we'll celebrate the anniversary for that in on August 6th. So we've got a long way to go. It's a cultural shift that has to happen, but I also think there has to be a recognition that the voting system in this country wasn't built for everybody. So it's going to take a long time to correct it. And there's some things that we can do besides just getting informed and getting involved. And that's first getting registered to vote and getting involved with organizations that are doing work to help move this work forward. Like ours.
Yes. Thank you. Rashad, Color of Change does a lot of great work for racial justice, such as including reducing mass incarceration and changing hiring practices in Hollywood. A unique point is how you're changing culture through the power of storytelling. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, so I talk a lot about narrative change and storytelling because it's so incredibly important to us being able to sort of drive in. I talked some about sort of how the campaigns animate themselves, right, in terms of our ability to push for reforms in terms of how we deal with TV. But, you know, I know that I end up in a lot of rooms where white folks will say, what can I do to be helpful? I end up in rooms with Black folks who will say, what can I do to be helpful? And I want to give you some things that you can just do in your own life as you talk about these issues. And the doctor sort of really, I think, set me up really well for this. And Stephanie set this up really well just in talking about sort of the historical aspects of these issues and the medical aspects of these issues. And so, you know, far too often, we don't say what we mean. And so we will say things like Black communities and Black people are vulnerable. And you know, vulnerability is a personal trait. So I feel vulnerable maybe when I see an ex on social media too happy. And that's when I need to like do something for myself. I need to talk to my therapist. I need to work on myself so I don't respond in a way that is, you know, not gonna be my best self. But vulnerability, our communities are not vulnerable. We've been attacked. We've been targeted. We've been exploited. And so when we talk about Black communities as vulnerable, what we do is we use this social service language that oftentimes then has people working to fix our communities and our families rather than fixing the systems and the structures that have harmed us. We will say Black people are less likely to get loans from the banks instead of banks are less likely to get loans from Black people. One way we end up putting the harm on having Black people in a whole bunch of financial literacy programs that don't actually deal with the facts that for the very beginning of banking, they have systemically excluded us from actually being in banking. We will say things like Black people are less likely to get jobs in the tech industry, instead of saying the tech industry is less likely to hire Black people. On one hand, we get a whole lot of programs that are about mentorship and pipeline programs that are meant to get us into systems that are already racist and systemically exclude us, rather than fixing those systemically excluding systems. And so what I mean by how we can constantly actually put the emphasis on what we mean, when we say what we mean, we can actually then put the focus on fixing systems rather than fixing people. Because what ends up happening is we far too often tell stories through storytelling that are unfortunate around injustice, right? They almost make inequality look like a car accident, like it sort of just happened rather than unjust. And when we talk about these things as unfortunate rather than unjust, we end up with what I like to talk about as charitable solutions to structural problems. So we get really happy after we've sent water bottles to Flint, but we don't deal with the fact where we've like have to change our tax structure. So some communities don't simply end up with dirty lead pipes and don't have clean water. We pat ourselves on the back for doing that service and mentorship day at that inner city school. And weren't those kids so beautiful and smart and talented, but we don't actually invest in dealing with a tax structure, which has exploited and created austerity and made that school actually not have the funding that they actually need. Charitable solutions to structural problems may make us feel better in the short term, but they actually don't build the type of systemic and structural change that actually makes for these changes happen. We also mistake presence for power, visibility and awareness and retweets. And look, as an organization that works really hard to build presence, presence is really important. So having visibility and presence is important. We do it at Color of Change. And so I'm not saying that presence is bad. I'm saying when we mistake presence for power, we think that we've done something that we actually haven't done. So if we mistake the fact that we've got a whole lot of Black pop stars that America loves as being that we're powerful, we can sort of trick ourselves into thinking that America loves Black people as much as it loves Black culture. And America can love Black culture and hate Black people at the same time. In fact, those things don't actually have to work in conflict with one another. And the final thing I guess I want to say about the stories we tell, right, is that, you know, so much of what we're seeing right now from COVID to this policing crisis to so many other things are Black pain and Black violence in front of us. Violence on Black bodies, violence on Black communities, Black people rising up, Black pain, it's in front of us constantly. And we're talking about disparities. We're talking about all the ways in which Black people are harmed. And that can kind of get us into this mindset that that's all we talk about when we talk about Black people. And I want to make sure that as much as we talk about Black pain, we have to talk about Black joy. And Black joy is not the absence of pain, but it's the presence of aspiration, not just what we are fighting against, but what we are fighting for. We have to talk about Black brilliance and Black creativity and all the ways in which Black people are the protagonists in the American story of voting. No people in this country have fought harder to vote, stood on longer lines, dealt with more barriers to actually get to the polls and make it happen. Black people are the protagonists in the story of education. No people have actually had to suffer more indignities to actually learn how to read and be educated in this country. The threat of violence at simply getting a book and actually being able to read, and that is part of a history. Because when we only talk about these sort of issues from a pejorative mindset, we end up with people pushing back on us with like themes of like, what about Black on Black crime? Because it's always about fixing Black communities. When I say white people kill more white people than anybody else, and when we live around each other, violence happens in our communities. But you know what actually makes our communities less violent? When we actually invest in communities and ensure we have parks and schools and healthcare and all of the things. And so part of what we actually have to do is tell a new story that actually empowers and puts at the center of our fight for liberation, not a conversation about charity, but a conversation about justice. And that is whether you are Black, whether you are white, whether you are brown, whether you sort of are a mix of all of those things, however you may identify and however you may fall, what we have to actually build is a new type of power, a new type of understanding, and a new type of advocacy that tells the story that gets us to the things that we actually want and that our communities actually deserve. And so all of that, right, is this conversation. And so as you are hearing things that may make you feel uncomfortable, like they're talking about, you know, defunding the police. Let's be clear, we have defunded education, we have defunded healthcare, we have defunded so many things in Black communities. And I said a little while ago that violent crime has gone down for the last 20 years, but policing budgets have gone up. And we have put a whole lot of money into putting police on the street and not putting food on the table, not putting economic development into communities. So budgets are moral documents, and that's why we have to tell the story. And we have to, through our work and advocacy, make those budgets actually say the things that we want them to say and do the things that we want them to do. And if we actually value people's full potential, then we'll invest in their potential, not invest in the control of them. We will invest in people being everything that they could possibly be, not investing in keeping a knee on their necks. That is actually how we, in this moment, translate presence into power, the visibility and awareness of this moment into the ability to actually change the rules. And changing the rules has to be the standard that we have. That is what this moment deserves. And that, I think, is what we can all be part of. And so for those of you who are looking for a political home, a place to sort of raise your voice and do that, I want to welcome you into Color of Change, because we help you take action. Meaningful action, strategic action in places all around the country where you can channel that presence, channel that outrage, channel that awakening and new awareness into the type of strategic action that will actually make real change.
Yes, all of that. Storytelling, the full complete story and the power of words. Let's talk more about what it looks like to begin to fix things. Dr. Tettey, what do you see happening with protests in support of the Black Lives Matter movement, and what tools do people need to really affect change, the best change?
Sure. So what I see happening is a movement towards change. I think people have had enough. I will say, as someone who's been in this field for the last 15 years, I am shocked in ways when it seems for a lot of people that this information is brand new. It seems for many people that they're just realizing that there's racism in the United States, and that's odd to me. So there's a part of me that's, you know, saying what is that about? But there's another side that's happy that at least something is moving forward. And so we'll take that and do what we can with the momentum that we have now. I saw something on social media that said the young people that we see really pushing this movement forward were kids when Trayvon Martin was murdered. And so now that they're at the age where they can actually affect change, they are doing that. They are letting their voices be heard. They're attaching themselves to movements, creating their own movements where change will be made. And I think it's very promising. I think it feels like there is a different energy around this, and I hope that that is the case. I hope that this is not just for the moment, but this is a long-term movement. In terms of things that we can do going forward, I think Rashad covered that very well in his last response. But I will say, in public health, we have a framework called the ecological model. And it states that if we're going to address a problem, we can't just have one solution. We have to address it from various different levels. And so the five levels that we approach problems from is the individual, interpersonal, community, organizational, and policy. So as we're talking about social injustice, at the individual level, people have to educate themselves, especially the people who are just waking up to the issues that are going on in this country, and they cannot rely on Black people to take on that responsibility for them, to educate them. There's too much information out there that's readily available for people to understand what has been going on in this country. Stephanie spoke about the horrors that people have had to face as it relates to voting. And when you read about the terror that has been imposed on Black people in this country, it is outrageous. And so I think everybody needs to educate themselves to fully understand the trauma that has been put upon this group of people. At the interpersonal level, people need to be more conscious about the racist acts, racist conversations that are going on within their families, within their friendships, among them and their colleagues, and call it out when they see it, when they hear it. Also, be more of the frame mind of anti-racism. So using that with your children, with your families, with your colleagues as well, not just saying, oh, I don't approve of that, but taking action steps to be anti-racist. At the community level, we do need to create communities that promote health, that promote well-being. One form of racism that's often not talked about is the idea of just not caring. So health disparities have been around. This conversation did not just start with COVID-19. People have known that certain communities do not have what they need to thrive and to move out of a certain condition, and they haven't cared. One thing that we have seen with this COVID-19 crisis, when money is needed, money will be made available, right? So we have to make sure that we are investing in these communities and that we're holding the people who are accountable to this, that we are making sure that they do what is right. At the organizational level, again, we do need to create more spaces and more opportunities for Black people in leadership positions where decisions are made. That is very important. And we cannot just talk about diversity. A lot of organizations now are putting out these statements and they're kind of talking around the issue. But we need to make consistent, sustainable policies that will be long lasting instead of just putting up a banner or something saying that you support the movement. How are you supporting the movement? And how is it going to be something long lasting? And I also agree that the last level, the policy level, is the most important. That's where we're going to see the most lasting change. So creating laws that increase funding for communities, that work to improve police community relations, anything that can be put into writing, put into law, made as policy, is really what's going to help us to see change for the long term.
Absolutely. Stephanie, what's your perspective? How do we move from protest to effect real change?
Well, what I like to say is, how do we move from right now, from protest to the ballot box? And we see all this action, all this energy, and my hope, wish, prayer, and everything that we're working on right now is to make sure that people move from the streets to their ballot box. New York, you have a primary coming up this Tuesday, but voting obviously is extremely important. That's one thing everybody can do. So first, everybody can get registered. Meetup has their very own portal that you can go to right now. It's weall.vote/meetup. You can go get registered right there. I'll put in the chat for folks as well. You can always step up and become a voting squad captain. In 2018, we created this hashtag to get folks out to vote in midterm elections, and Mrs. Obama announced, go get your voting squad, get your voting squad together, hashtag it, let us see your photos, and that went pretty big. So we decided to create an organization, a volunteer organization, where you have to apply, but it's not that strenuous. You can become a voting squad captain, and then you can organize your own community. That can be your friends, your family, your church, whoever. Doesn't matter, but you can pick people no less than three. It could be 1,000 if you wanted to be, doesn't matter, no limits. And make sure that you are funneling all the important information to them when it comes to making their voices heard at the polls. We give you all the tools and resources. You can sign up to do that at weall.vote/meetup squad. I'll also put that in the chat. And then we want folks to mobilize around safe voting practices. As COVID hit, we knew that we needed to take a stand, and through Mrs. Obama, we announced our support for the expansion of vote by mail, the expansion of early in-person voting, and also the expansion of online voter registration. There are 13 states that do not allow you to register online, Texas, Arkansas, so they make it a little harder for people to get registered and ready to vote. And then when it comes to absentee ballots, most states you have to request it. It doesn't just miraculously appear. So there are 5 states that will send it to you automatically, Oregon, Utah, and some others. And I'm sorry, Colorado, Utah, and some others. And with the other states, there's 33 states where you have to request your absentee ballot. So we want to make sure that you know about all of those things and all those ways you can make your voices heard. And right before the election, right before your primary, which probably has passed this point. But for the general election, we're gonna send out all that information to the folks who are signed up with us to make sure that they know when to request their absentee ballot, when to turn it in. There's all of these deadlines, and we wanna make sure that you have those information at your fingertips. And we also want you to take the pledge and advocate for these provisions. There's already legislation right now that's in the Senate that will help to provide funding for states to expand access to all of these things. You don't really hear about it. There's so much going on, but it's important that you take a stand, and we provide all the information you need right now to call your member of Congress or your senator to push for this. And you go to weall.vote/meetup safe voting. I'll also put that in your in this chat as well. I'd also encourage folks to get educated. And make sure that you know as much as you can about this country and voting. And I encourage you to watch documentaries like Rigged, that's on Amazon right now. It talks about voter suppression. It's a voter suppression handbook. It talks about how it happened, when it happened most recently, and what's going on, and what really happened in our last midterm election season and in 2016. So please, please watch Rigged. I'd also encourage you to watch Reconstruction, which is on PBS. You can get that on demand. Henry Louis Gates, the esteemed professor at Harvard University, created this documentary about the Reconstruction period in this country, which really illuminates and shares. It talks a lot about voting and how voting was not provided for everyone, but how engaged the electorate was and then disengaged through terrorist organizations like the KKK and others. And then also I'd encourage people to vote your values. At the end of the day, you have to make sure that you're aligning yourself with the people that represent you and that you want to represent you, and get educated on who these people are. I know it feels like a lot, but we are that partner to help you sort through all of this. There's another organization that works really hard, and we partner with them called Ballot Ready, and it will show you your ballot, and it will literally click to different links and talk about all the different things these candidates have done in their careers or haven't done or what they're promising to do. And then after you vote for these folks, we want you to hold them accountable. So you have to stay engaged. And what does that mean? That means keeping up with what they're doing, sign up for their email list. I worked on Capitol Hill for many years as a communications director for the Congressional Black Caucus and also for the Democratic Whip at the time. Steny Hoyer is the National Press Secretary. And I'm gonna tell you, there are people on Capitol Hill every single day, from Rashad Robinson to many others who are lobbying their interests. I know lobbyists get a bad name, but there are people who are lobbying for good interests and people who are lobbying for bad interests. So you have to make sure that you stay engaged, because you can't give your power away. And every time that you decide not to vote, that is exactly what you're doing. So please join us at whenweallvote.org. There's so many ways that you can take action. We have so much for you to do. And we only got 5 months, guys. So we need as much help as possible. It's all hands on deck at this point.
Yes, thank you. And Rashad, same question for you. How do we move from protest to affect real change?
So, you know, I want to double click on everything that my other panelists said. I also want to just kind of add a little texture to it. I don't know if we should necessarily move from protest, but voting has to be a piece of what we do, right? We have to constantly protest. And Stephanie talked about this. We have to hold those in power accountable. And so I think about voting sort of in an exercise sort of analogy. Sort of like voting is sort of like to exercise, like it's kind of like to civic engagement. It's sort of like the stretching, right? Stretching alone probably won't help you lose all of that last 5 pounds if that is your goal, but you're gonna hurt later if you don't. And so you need to stretch, you need to vote because it's absolutely part of what you have to do to be powerful and to like not hurt later. And we have to recognize that voting is a piece of the puzzle, right? So many of the changes we are seeing right now in city councils that can suddenly magically cut money from policing budgets, start holding police accountable, right? Those same elected officials were there before, right? And if they were the wrong elected officials that we didn't have any accountability over, that would have been a different story. But now they are actually moving quicker because we have a new lever of power. We're able to push them in new ways. And that is because movements have pushed and changed. We have more people than ever showing up and wanting to engage and raise their voices. And yes, we need to channel those energy to voting, but we want to channel them to a whole set of things where I believe the levers can be pulled. And so I want to give you a couple of things that you can do to actually make that happen. And so at Color of Change, we've built the only searchable database of the 2,400 prosecutors in the country. And you can get it by going to winningjustice.org. winningjustice.org. You can also find it on our homepage, Color of Change. But winningjustice.org is the only searchable database. And you can go there and you can find that information about your district attorney. And we work with our volunteers and our members to help keep that site updated. And so you can sign up to be part of the effort to continue to like keep track of DAs. We've also built out 6 clear demands for district attorneys, working with partners on the ground from Black Lives Matter chapters to ACLUs to folks who are in the academic world looking at criminal justice, around 6 clear things that we can push district attorneys to do who are the most powerful actors in the criminal justice space. They determine whether or not a police are held accountable, and they determine who gets prosecuted or doesn't get prosecuted for crimes. The United States has 4% of the world's population and 25% of the world's incarcerated population. So if you've been motivated and mobilized by what's happening in Kentucky, what's happening in Minnesota, what's happening in Georgia, what's happening in so many other places around the country, I'm here to tell you that you probably live in a place with a district attorney who will not prosecute the police when they harm or hurt us. You probably live in a community where you have a district attorney that is running up mass incarceration. And so in the few places where we've been able to really get true progressive champions, we need to work to protect them and make sure they get reelected. But in places where we don't, we need to make sure that we hold them accountable. You know, I talk a lot about sort of what power looks like, and I talked about it as the ability to change the rules. But it is also ensuring that those in power are nervous about disappointing us. If decision makers are not nervous about disappointing us, it doesn't matter sort of what kind of research report we have that illustrates all the facts and figures. It doesn't matter what kind of apps and technology we have. It doesn't matter what we do in the courts because we can't implement it. And so we have to build a new level of power to hold those in office accountable. And we have to work to put the right people in office. And those two things have to go hand in hand. And so I just say that the path forward is a path of both voting and protest, a pathway of raising our voices and pushing back, a pathway of organizing locally. So join something in your community from a local grassroots organization. If you're engaged around racial justice, find a Black-led or Brown-led group in your community and follow them and join them and help them build power to challenge the systems that far too often stand in our way. And then let's challenge the power structures that oftentimes too long stand in the way of change. I believe that 5, 10, 15 years from now, we can look back at this moment and see so much change that we actually made. But it won't happen if we don't get in motion and find ways to collaborate, find ways to build together, find ways to fight together. It won't happen if we don't vote, but it also won't happen if we don't march, if we don't push back, if we don't reach out to our representatives, if we don't send a powerful message about how they will be held accountable if they don't listen to us. All of those things have to be part of building a future that all of us deserve and all of our communities need. And so join us at Color of Change. Obviously, sign up for When We All Vote. Follow organizations in your local community. Do all of those things. But now is the time to act. Awareness is not enough anymore. Being aware is just the first step. Action has got to be the bottom line for all of us.
Absolutely. Very well said. Thank you all for your insight. If anyone says they didn't learn something tonight, they are lying. So we will now move on to the Q&A segment, and any of you can jump in and answer. So the first question we have is from Emanuela, and she says, how can you motivate someone who thinks that there is no point in voting?
Well, that's a really good question, and I know there's a lot of people out there. I've talked to a lot of those folks. There's people in my family who feel that way. I think that we all have that. One thing I will say is this. Through our research, what we do know, and as you know, our organization was launched by Michelle Obama, who has a great profile, and most people do love her. She's not even the best messenger, but you are. So for the people that are in your life that depend on you, that love you, that respect you, you are the best messenger to help to make those connections for them. One thing that we're doing that we just did, I hope you go on our Instagram page, we just put up some graphics that really illuminate and show how each person in office affects your life personally. And I think that that is a breakdown that folks don't really understand. So I think it's talking about how elected officials impact your life. I think it's talking about all the things that folks are doing right now from their protests to their activism and connecting that next step, as Rashad said, it all works together. And one doesn't really work without the other. And everything that I think we're fighting for right now in this country is something that you actually can go vote about. And to make that sharp connection for people is so important, but also to walk them through the process. Sometimes people are embarrassed that they just don't know. So doing it with them, saying, hey, look, I'll sit down, I'll help you register to vote. I'll go with you to vote. What we know is that people are 4% more likely. I know that seems like a little bit, but when elections are determined by very few people, that's actually a lot. 4% more likely to actually vote when they do it together. So make sure that you do create that voting squad and you incorporate that person and you force them to be a part of that. And you say, I'm going to vote with you. And let's find out, let's do the research together. Let's look up this candidate. Let's talk about this issue. Let's see how it connects. And I know that that's not an easy kind of one-stop shop kind of fix. It's gonna take time. And I think it's gonna take continually talking to those people in your life. So we know is that most voters need at least 7 touches, meaning they need to at least be talked to, messaged to at least 7 times to be moved to action to register. That's a lot. So you can do that with the people in your life that you love. You can text them right now and say, hey, are you registered to vote? They can actually text vote to 56005 right now and get more information. Tell them that. And I'm sure that that will spark and start a conversation, a debate, an argument, but at least you're talking about it and don't stop talking about it.
Exactly. Next question is from Rochelle. She asks, are there new laws to prevent racist and unequal policies such as redlining from ever being implemented again?
No. I mean, there are definitely laws, but there's no laws on the books to help them ever being implemented again. I think we are in an era where both the written and unwritten rules constantly impact us in so many ways. And so, you know, one of the things we focus on at Color of Change a lot is the role of corporate power and in all of this work and the roles that banks can sometimes write the rules for banking, technology companies write the rules for technology, that police unions write the rules for police. all of these things are things that we actually have to fundamentally change. And voting is a piece of that puzzle, that we have to get the right people in office, that we hold accountable. We also have to create litmus tests for them once they're in office. But yeah, I mean, redlining exists in very clear ways. And while it may be sort of legally off the books, since 1980, sort of the black-white wealth income gap has and wealth gap has gone the other way. And a lot of that has been done because of housing policies. And in 2008, the kind of crisis of the economy that happened with the housing crisis impacted where big banks, targeted Black communities with, kind of hostile, messy loans. And now, Black communities actually lost, basically 75% of their wealth to big banks. It was one of the biggest redistributions of wealth from people who were basically middle class, working class, and poor up to the top 1%. That's a lot of politics. That's a lot of numbers. All of that to say that this is why it's actually so important that we are part of organizing movements and organizations, because when we take our feet off the gas, we allow for those who are lobbying on the other sort of side to gain more power. Stephanie talked about sort of all the lobbying that happens on Capitol Hill. And one thing that I think is really, really important to remember here is that every time a kind of smaller grassroots organization like mine leaves the room, a big corporation that may have a CEO that makes as much as my sort of annual budget walks in with his briefcase and the things that he wants. We do not have the money, but we have the people, and I believe the people organized can win, but that means we actually need more people in motion with us.
And I just wanted to add to that response, we also have to, as I was stating before, do work on the individual level, because even if there was a policy that made redlining completely illegal, whatever that would look like, there could still be a real estate person who has implicit bias, unconscious bias, who's going to engage in racial steering. And so it might not look like redlining, but they're going to take you to XYZ neighborhood because they have an opinion of who you are, where you should live, where you shouldn't live, what you shouldn't have access to. So until we start doing that deep work and being aware of the biases that we all may have as it pertains to various issues, and specifically for white people that they have as it pertains to Black people. I think the book, How to Be an Anti-Racist, really spells out what I'm talking about and shows it really descriptively in terms of what it looks like when someone might say, oh, I'm not racist, I don't have anything against this particular group, but you see that group as someone who needs, a group that needs your help, someone to be pitied, someone who's not as good, that you don't want around you necessarily, or you want to keep them away from other people, so to speak. All of those things are in the mix when we're talking about real estate and housing. So again, there might be a law that comes out somewhere about that prevents redlining, but until we do the personal work, there are still people who work within these organizations, and their actions can still manifest.
Absolutely. We do not have time for any more questions, but that was so fantastic and impactful. Thank you so much, all of you, for your insight, for your wisdom, for sharing your experiences, for guiding us through this conversation. We couldn't thank you more. Thank you to all the attendees who participated today and listened in on this. And wherever you are in the globe, we hope that you have a good night, and we'll share all the data and resources with you after this session. Thank you all.
Thank you.